Hello, buongiorno, bonjour, guten tag, dzień dobry. I'm Łukasz Jenaś, I work as a software engineer for Allegro Group. Since the Havana release, I'm a volunteer translator for OpenStack. I've been involved in translations since 2004, started with the GNOME project. I hope I give you some hints how to translate properly, where to start, how to operate our infrastructure, and what roadblocks you may hit on your way. So first, maybe I'll tell you why start being a translator anyway. What are the reasons I became one, what it gave me. Then we'll talk about the tools and processes we're currently using on OpenStack, and a few stories from the trenches which I encountered over the years. So how does one end up as a translator anyway? First, it's an easy entry point into open source. When you want to start doing open source, providing new software for people, translations is an easy way to get you involved. Because if you can read English, you probably can translate it into your own language. Also, these days it's not difficult. When I started 10 years ago, I had to know specialized tools, be accustomed with version control, know some magic variables, do a lot of unnecessary stuff. These days, you just go to a web page, click translate, and you're done. Okay. You actually don't have to know any programming language to develop in some way software. Of course, there are some variables you have to take care of, but it's nothing special, nothing that requires any specific knowledge of programming. And translating software is a good way to help others in your county. It's also a good way to have a higher user base, because not everyone has to know English to use your software. Of course, IT professionals usually do know some English, but we have to work with our users, and we shouldn't expect them to know it. Okay. Also, it's a good way to improve your own language skills. When translating software, you have to accustom yourself with many dictionaries, thesauses, and glossaries. For me, my career in translation provided me with a better vocabulary. Now I tend to build better sentences in my own language. Of course, this has a minor downside in that I pay the double rates for my text messages. And you should be proud of your own native language. Diversity in open source is a good thing. Diversity makes open source software different from the commercial one, which is usually developed in a specific culture and sometimes hard to translate into another part of the world. Okay, maybe let's go to the tools and processes we're employing in OpenStack. First and foremost, the community. The most important piece. It's the one thing that made me do translations in the first place, because in some communities we tend to have annual parties, and pretty much we're becoming friends over time. One place to contact us is the OpenStack IE10A mailing list. It's low traffic for now, so if you have any questions, if you want to know more about translating, please go and ask. Other means is the OpenStack Translation IRC channel on the Finode network. We are there. Of course, sometimes we can respond in 5 minutes, but someone eventually will respond to you. Okay, our primary workloads now is the TensorFlow platform, where most of us do the actual translation. Okay, after logging in, you should find the OpenStack organization, and you'll get to a similar screen where you can select your project. For example, we focus mostly on the Horizon project, which is the OpenStack dashboard. Then you select your language, join a language team if you haven't done so already, and just click Translate. Okay, that's your main UI for working with TransFX and the translations. It's separated into three groups. On the left, you find the string list, which contains the entire list of strings in a given project, together with the translations. In the middle, you have the actual workplace, where on the upper side, you find the English string. In the middle, you find your edit box to translate it. And below, some contextual information about the location of this thing, in what file is it, and any information that developers could add to it. On the right, you find some useful tabs, which I'll describe later, exactly now. An important tab is the suggestions box, which contains suggestions based on previously translated strings, and the amount a given string matches to your current one. Next is the history, which the name implies is the history of the item. And one useful thing is the glossary, where you find description definitions and sample translations for a given string, and of course, the comments. Okay. Another set of tools used by our team is the trio of Jenkins, Zool, and Gate. Any of you know what these are? So. Okay, so Jenkins is our build system. It does the actual work. Gate is a system where developers review the code, they comment on it, and which then triggers Zool to do some jobs. The process is as follows: when a developer merges a patch to a project, a post-commit job is run by Zool, which accepts the translatable strings, and then they push the TransFX, and then the developer translates it, and every day another job is run, which pulls down the strings from TransFX, and proposes as a patch for a gate for the developers to approve. They don't check the actual contents of the file or in the translation, only that it doesn't break the build. And at the end, the process repeats itself over and over again. Okay, maybe go to the promise dragons. The phrase "Hebrew dragons" comes from old maps, where places that were either unknown or dangerous were marked by a phrase "Hebrew dragons" to warn other sailors to not venture into this area. Some people tend to think that translation work is easy, but there are a few situations where it can be really, really hard and really tough to do properly. Well, for example, there was a story about the colon bug. So when I was translating the Ice House release, I've noticed that there are many strings that seem to be duplicated, which are different only in the ending. For example, you have image details colon space, and image details colon. So I proposed that we just get rid of the trailing spaces, trailing colons, so that a translator would end up with only one string to translate. In that case, when we had three strings, every string could be translated differently because they appear in different places in the TensorFlex UI. Some of them are at the beginning of release, some are in the middle, some are at the end. In that case, these things were meaning the same, but one of these things was the page title, the second one was a header, and the third one was in a message. Okay. But then can I email to the mailing list by Douglas Fitch, which said, while I understand the need for consistency, I just got the request from a French translator to do the opposite implementation. The translator of French shared with me that the punctuation as part of the translator material makes it much easier to create a correct translation. In French, a colon is expected between the final word and the final punctuation, including a colon. So I said, oops, the whole patch which is already prepared had to be averted. In the end, there was some discussion on the mailing list, and in the end, we decided to keep the colon, but get rid of any spaces at the end of the sentences because we couldn't find any possible language where this was needed. And another case which you have to look out is string concatenation. It's a common thing for developers to do something like that. My name is plus a variable and Kowalski. Unfortunately, for a translator, this will be two strings without any context because the variable will be lost and wouldn't appear anyway in the translation system. So a better form would be my name is %s Kowalski, which would end up in the translation system as a single string, and also give us information that inside that is another string. But the best version is my name is first name Kowalski, which tells the translator that there's a variable called first name, which gives us context. So it usually won't appear another Kowalski, but probably it will be John or Alice or something. And it's way better to translate and won't end up in any errors, at least it shouldn't. Okay, another issue we have with translating software from English to another language is plural forms. English is easy, it's either singular or plural, but for example in Polish we have at least 3 plural forms. Some languages are even more complicated. So let's see, for example, there's one file, 2399 files, but in Polish it's one plik, 254 pliki, 521 plików, then 22 to 24 pliki again, and then plików again. So,
sorry? You finish at 32. What's after 32? Keep repeating?
32 pliki again. Yeah. And 0 is plików. Okay, so the usual convention where the developer does that if a variable count is, for example, more than 1, then do another thing. This doesn't work. Fortunately, there's something like get text, which when we pass a variable to it, it forces to appear in TensorFlex in the proper way, so we can select for the one form, the few forms, and the other forms, and it allows us for a good translation. Unfortunately, for Polish, we can't do a proper translation because we're missing the number of instances here. So but at least without the number, we can do a more proper translation that just copies that one over here. Usually there should be a number. And the most complicated thing is declension. For example, the nouns which have 10 different forms. Let's look at that sample string where we have viewing something, a variable where the variable is substituted by map, by instance, by whatever. So for the translator, would end up with two things. One would be viewing types. Another would be map, which means a singular form is mapper. Unfortunately, the thing is a routing thing with Tanya mapper, which is wrong in Polish and in many other languages also. Because mapper declares like that, like there is who wrote mapper, whose word mapy, mapie, mapę, mapu, mapie I mapu. But in the previous sentence, we would have to use the genitive form, so the sentence will end up jak wyświetlanie mapy, viewing map. So the previous translation that which didn't have the context would be wrong, totally, actually. It's even hard to read in Polish. Okay, so it's better to not substitute the variable as a the variable content as a variable, but match it somewhere else and replace it with the whole sentence. Okay, and the last thing I hit yesterday is a warning for designers: don't use fonts that contain only ASCII characters because you'll end up with that. Something's missing. Yeah. Okay. Of course, translators are always welcome. There are a few of us. We would like it to be more, especially for Polish, where I'm the single coordinator translator and whatever you can find. The best way is to go to our wiki. There's a more detailed procedure about how everything works. Of course, there's the mailing list. You can chat with us. And a final link to the project that is translated most, so OpenStack Dashboard. So thanks for those who stayed. And also thanks for Allegro.io for allowing me to be here. And if you have any questions, can you please go up to the mic? Yeah.
I've tried to create translations before, but not for OpenStack. And I'm just curious how you came to do it, and specifically when you very first started doing it, what were some of maybe simple but big issues you ran into at the very beginning?
The issues I ran were that my desktop environment wasn't fully translated, and that's why I started doing the translations, actually. And I had to learn, in GNOME we use SVN to translate the projects. We had a separate team which we pull the translations from the GNOME repository and then merge them back. And really the hardest thing was getting the developer to merge that patch with the updated translation. The hardest thing was to get the developer to merge the updated translation into the back into GNOME.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Okay. So, thanks.